Okay, let's get started. As far as I'm concerned, this is just a fun lecture. One thing I do want to say is there is... Yeah. There is information in all of the handouts that is not necessarily in the PowerPoint presentations that you will be examined on, so make sure you go through the handouts as well. Okay, today's lecture is on bioterrorism, and as I said, this is a fun lecture. I enjoy this lecture anyway. So, okay, what is bioterrorism? It is the intentional or threatened use of viruses, bacteria, fungi, or toxins from living organisms to produce death or disease in humans, animals, or plants. And since we really aren't interested in the animals or plant aspects here, we're talking about humans. Why biological attacks? Well, the biological things, they're easy to obtain, or they used to be easy to obtain. They're not so easy anymore. They're pretty inexpensive to produce. They're environmentally stable. Anthrax spores can last up to 50 years. You can distribute them via aerosols, which makes it very easy to do. You can get, this is one of the big keys here, is you can get delayed responses and recognition. That gives your perpetrators a chance to escape. You have a susceptible population because there's not necessarily an immunization available. Okay, now let's take a look at, biological warfare has been used throughout history. Starting as early as 400 BC, when archers would dip their arrows in manure or blood and rotting corpses in order to shoot them at people, which sounds like fun, doesn't it? In the 14th century, the bubonic plague victims were catapulted over walls in order to spread bubonic plague into the cities. So obviously they knew that you could spread bubonic plague. The Spanish, knowing how much French liked their wine, would put blood from leprosy victims into wine, get it to the French. A Polish general in the 17th century put the saliva from rabid dogs into hollow artillery spheres. And this just shows you how wonderful we are. In the 18th century, we gave smallpox blankets to the American Indians. Now, the U.S. Biological Warfare Program. In 1925, Geneva set up, there was a convention in Geneva set up a set of protocols. We started our offensive program in 1943, which is a good few years after the setup of the protocols. But we didn't actually even start our defensive program until 10 years later, in 1953. And we didn't abandon the program until 1969. And we didn't actually have a convention on it until 1972. And we didn't ratify the Geneva Protocol until 1975. So we have a long time in here to actually work on biological warfare. So, in the United States itself, has there ever been much use of biological agents? Well, yeah. College students in 1972 made 30 to 40 kilograms of salmonella and planned to use it in water supply in the Midwest. I would say they were not real happy college students. Then in 1984, a cult up in Oregon wanted to put salmonella in salad bars so they could win an election. They didn't actually win the election, but 715 people came down with salmonella food poisoning. 1992, Patriots Council plotted to kill law enforcement officers with ricin. Somebody informed on them, though, so nothing really happened there, fortunately. 1995, Larry Wayne Harris got plague from the ATCC. This was back in a time when anybody could order anything from the American Type Culture Collection. And he did. He was found out, and they found the vials unopened. But at that point, anybody who wanted to could order any bacteria they wanted to from the American Type Culture Collection. But that has actually changed now. You can't just order plague or anthrax from the American Type Culture Collection. I like this one. A lab tech in 1996 was upset with her coworkers, and she brought donuts spiked with Shigella in for their lab break. And we all know about 2001 with the anthrax letters. There were actually 22 cases, one of which was a laboratory-acquired case. 11 people died, or 11 people got inhalation anthrax. 11 people had skin anthrax, but only 5 people died. Remember the panic? People were ironing their letters. People were buying gas masks. They were putting duct tape on their windows. It's the kind of panic that this sort of thing causes. And the kind of panic that as physicians, you're going to have to deal with if this sort of thing happens again when you become physicians and you have practices. This is the kind of things that people are going to come into your office panicked about. Oh my goodness, New York City had an anthrax attack. What do I do here in South Carolina? You know, that's a little distance, but people panic. Okay. What do you consider in selecting the agents that are for biological warfare? First thing they have to consider is the catastrophic public health consequences. What is something that's going to terrify people and cause major panic? Exactly, yeah. You want something that is going to cause mass casualties and overwhelm the medical system. You want something that's going to cause a lot of people to come into the system quickly. And they don't even have to be sick. Again, panic can do that. Mass casualties are nice. Look at the situation when you had the Twin Towers are a good example of mass casualties from the trauma. But it overwhelmed the system. If you can overwhelm the system with the disease, you'll also cause the same sort of thing. You want high morbidity or mortality. High morbidity works as well. You got a bunch of people sick. They don't have to die. They just have to get sick. If it's contagious, it's even better. You get something that's contagious, like the flu. Look at the situation we've got now with the swine flu. Everybody's panicking. Oh my gosh, you got a cough in your elbow. So everybody's going in their elbow. I mean, how many people do you see doing that? We all cough the way we normally cough. What are the main bioterrorist weapons? What are the biological agents that have the highest concern? We talked about these yesterday. Bacillus anthracis, Yersinia pestis, and Francisella tularensis. Now these others, two of them are viruses, which you'll talk about later, and the other one is botulism toxin. And that's because it's one of the major toxins, and very small amounts of it will kill you. So, but the only ones I'm going to talk about here are the only ones I know anything about, which are the biological, the bacteriological agents. Margaret could tell you about viruses. I don't know very much about viruses. This is key. Most of the information that we have on what would happen in a biological attack is based on what we know about the natural disease, because except in the anthrax attack, there's never been a biological attack. So we don't know what would happen if there was a Francisella attack, because there hasn't been one. So all we can do is say, okay, if there's a Francisella attack, what could we expect? Well, we know what happens if somebody comes down with Francisella. So that's all we can hope for. Now, with plague, we have some idea because there are naturally occurring plague epidemics. Why did these agents get picked? Aerosol route. Because that's what the government considers to be the most likely case. The most likely scenario is going to be an aerosol attack. These organisms are stable in aerosols. Well, that makes sense. If you're going to have an aerosol attack, you want the organisms to be stable in an aerosol. Again, you have a susceptible civilian population. There really is no vaccine or good vaccine available for the civilian population for any of these organisms. High morbidity, mortality. Some person-to-person transmission with small with the plague, you've got person-to-person transmission. Remember when we were talking about diagnosis and treatment, especially diagnosis with these, they all look like flu to begin with. Another biggie. They were all previously developed for biological warfare. That's why they're on the list, because we know they're out there and they've been developed for biological warfare. In fact, I turned on to the Animal Planet last night and they were talking about Brucella. Brucella is one of the agents, but it's not as bad as the three we were talking about, but it is on the B list. They were talking that Russia had spent a lot of time and effort on Brucella, and now they've hired a lot of these Russian scientists to work on vaccines for the buffalo in Yellowstone, because the buffalo in Yellowstone are infected with Brucella, and if the buffalo get out of Yellowstone, they kill them. So they're trying to work with these scientists, number one, to give them a job so that they don't go other places and start working on these organisms in other countries that might use them against us, but to help these buffalo. I thought that was kind of cute. Alvin thought it was stupid, but he thought, yeah, well, why are we bothering with this? Why can't we spend the money on more important things? But whatever. There are three different categories of bioterrorist agents. The A list, or the top category. These organisms are easily transmitted, easily disseminated. They have a high mortality rate. There's a potential with these agents for a major public health impact. They can cause public panic and social disruption, which is what you saw with anthrax. They require special action for public health preparedness. And again, anthrax, pestis, and tularensis are the bacterial agents in this group. The category B agents are just down from that. They have moderate morbidity. Not mortality, but morbidity. With low mortality, they require non-standard diagnostic tests. They're moderately easy to distribute. The big thing here is enhanced disease surveillance. This is where the Brucella come in. You got Coxsackie Burnetti, or Q fever, psittacosis, Chlamydia psittaci, Burkholderia, another Burkholderia, Rickettsia. This is where we start to get into some other forms of threats other than air. You get water threats, you get Vibrio cholera and a protozoa. Now, when I went into the CDC, which is the one that comes up with this list, this is the only thing that had changed. The food threats are the only thing that had really changed. Now they're including the E. coli 0157H7, Salmonella serotype typhimurium, Salmonella serotype enteritidis, Shigella sonii, Shigella flexneri, Dysenteria type 1, and Salmonella typhi, and Vibrio cholera. None of these were included last year. So obviously, they're feeling a lot more threatened with food supply now. Category C is an interesting category. Basically, it covers everything that's not covered in A or B. Newly discovered diseases, easily obtained agents, easy to make and distribute, potential for high morbidity and mortality. Basically, that's a catch-all. Anything that they couldn't figure out or anything that might come up later. So, you've got an agent. What kind of attacks could we have? Well, we've seen this. That was an unannounced attack, but you can have announced attacks. Those are considered overt attacks. Or unannounced attacks, or covert attacks. So you got likely scenarios. With an overt attacks, you have the anthrax letters. You have bombs and releases into things like air conditioning and heating systems. With covert attacks, you have things, they release it into your food or water. You have aerosol releases or zoonotic attacks. What happens? Okay, if you have an overt attack, they're telling you it's happening, so you have early recognition that the event's happening. With a covert attack, you have delayed recognition of the attack. You have an early response versus a delayed response. Early treatment versus delayed treatment. And what does this mean? This means that with an overt attack, the people who are most threatened are your first responders, your police, your emergency personnel, that sort of thing. But with a covert attack, healthcare workers are the front line because these are the people, the doctor's offices, the clinics, these are the people that are going to get exposed first. It's not going to be a first responder. It's going to be your doctor's office. It's going to be your emergency room. But it's not going to be your ambulance worker. It's going to be the nurse who triages or the doctor who sees not the doctor who sees the trauma, but the doctor who sees the walk-in. Delivery systems. With air, the aerosol is the most is considered to be the most effective dissemination method. If you put it in water, it's extremely diluted. So you have to have a lot of it, or you have to have something that requires a very low level for damage. Droplet size. You talk to the air people, and they get really hung up on this droplet size thing because it has to be a certain size to get into the lungs. So this is really important to the air people. Food, water, skin and mucous membranes. For skin and mucous membranes, it would have to be on surfaces, or it would have to be in an aerosol, but could be heavy enough that it would land on your skin. How do you prepare for a bioterrorist attack? First thing you have to do is you have to be able to recognize that it's happening. I was at a meeting this summer in Italy, and the main function of this meeting, it was a NATO meeting, it was on bioterrorism. This environmental detection is not feasible, still applies. There is a lot of money that has been put into environmental detection. In fact, Copenhagen and Denmark have put a huge amount of money. They have come up with this, it's like a tank, and supposedly it pulls in huge amounts of air and tests the air for these biological agents. It is the closest to being ready for real time, but it still hasn't been tested in real time, and it's the closest. And they have spent billions of dollars. U.S. has put money into it. The European Union has put money into it. And again, it's still not ready for prime time. And that's the closest of all the nations that's ready. You have to know what your incubation periods are, because you have to know about the delay. And we talked about that with the diseases. If you are going through an airport and you've got thousands of people going through Atlanta, going all over the world, and you've got ranging incubation periods, they're all going to be everywhere by the time they get sick. You need to know that most of the diseases are going to mimic the flu at the very beginning. But some of them can incapacitate. You can get paralysis, coma, and death almost immediately, especially with the toxins. This is for the clinicians. You have to maintain a high level of suspicion in a number of clinical situations. If you find that there's people coming in with that are normally healthy, a normal healthy population, and all of a sudden there's a bunch of normally healthy people that come in with these diseases that just, it doesn't make sense that they would have them, you have to be suspicious. If you've got an epidemic of these people that come and go very quickly, you have to be suspicious. If you've got an unusual rise in the number of people seeking care for fever, respiratory, or GI complaints, and it's not in the time frame that you would expect for the flu, endemic diseases. As I said, there's Brucella is endemic in South Carolina and in the South and in the Southeast. You see an incredible number of Brucella cases. Well, first of all, you know that shouldn't happen, because you should only see it if somebody's been out hunting. And you see moms who don't go hunting, whose husbands don't go hunting, coming in your office with Brucella. That's got to raise a flag. You see people coming in the office with tularemia who don't go outdoors, who are not going to get ticks, who don't have dogs or cats, who are not going to get bitten by ticks. So people who are coming in with diseases that, again, it doesn't make sense. A bunch of soccer moms come in, and their kids come in, but nobody else is coming in with the same diseases. Clusters of people who come in from a single location, or a bunch of people come in who've been to the same football game. A large number of rapidly fatal cases. People who come in with a disease that is relatively uncommon and has a bioterrorist potential. This is something you don't usually think about, and you would probably see it in the paper, but concurrent reports of increased animal deaths. All of a sudden, a bunch of dogs and cats are dying, and it's reported in the newspaper. You think, whoa, that's kind of weird. But remember, animals are susceptible to these diseases as well. An unusual age distribution. An atypical disease presentation. A lot of these diseases, too, have been designed with antibiotic resistance genes in them. So they're not going to present normally. Now, how do you prepare for bioterrorism? There has been a huge amount of money put aside in this country for preparation for bioterrorism. The federal government has put a lot of money into making sure that police departments and fire departments have training in preparedness. And our DHEC has had training in preparedness, and the clinical labs and hospitals have had training for preparedness. But again, if we don't have another attack, all of this money is going to go away, and all of this preparedness is just going to get slowly going to go away. And these people who have been prepared are not going to be prepared. You have to develop and use epidemiological tools. I don't know how much epidemiology that you guys get. I know that it's more of a public health thing than it is an MD thing. But in your histories, you need to be aware of exposure history. Because remember, when in the clinical scenarios I've given you, history plays an important role in figuring out how this person was exposed. Travel to a location that has a high consequence disease transmission. Remember, with like Brucella, if you've been to the Middle East and you drink camel milk, okay, well, then you probably have there's a high probability that you can come down with Brucella. But if you've been to Maine and drunk camel milk, there's less likelihood that you're going to come down. First of all, there's less likelihood you'll find a camel. But if you find a camel and drink camel milk, you're probably not going to come down with Brucella. Unusual antibiotic resistance. That's a big one. Because, again, most of these pathogens that have been designed for biological warfare have unusual antibiotic resistance patterns, simply because they know what antibiotics we're going to give them, so they fixed so that they will not be susceptible to those antibiotics. Most of the organisms that are on this list are on the reportable diseases. In fact, Francisella was dropped from the reportable diseases. Then this whole nine yards of the bioterrorism started, and it was put back on the reportable diseases. Okay, the American Academy for Family Physicians, this is what they suggest: that you know how to contact your local and state health departments. You maintain your contact with these local officials. That sounds easy, but in an emergency, it may not be that simple to figure out who you need to talk to, because the person that you need to talk to may not be obvious. You need to keep reference material on treatment and diagnosis, because it can change. You need to develop a plan for your office and infection control practices for your office for these agents. Know what you need for laboratory support. Know what kind of tests that you're going to need to perform. Know what you need to do for post-exposure management. It may be as simple as just starting everybody on antibiotics. This is a big thing. You're going to need to counsel your patients and your staff and your family and your friends in order to keep them calm. Okay. This is just a reminder. Anthrax, pestis, tularemia, brucella. Infectious doses. Look at this, 10 to 50 organisms, 10 to 100 organisms. Less than 100 organisms here, 8,000 to 50,000, and that's just the LD50. Variation, these are pretty low, 1 to 14, 1 to 7, 1 to 14, 5 to 60. 100% fatality, 55% fatality, 50 to 90% fatality, 30 to 60%. This is not, you know, less than 5% mortality, no big deal, right? Comparatively. I mean, when you're looking at 100% mortality, less than 5% doesn't seem all that great. But these are, again, these are all things we covered earlier. This is what I wanted you to look at here. Person-to-person spread. No, the only one that has person-to-person spread is pestis, and that's only with pneumonic. BSL-3, do you guys know what BSL-3 is and BSL-2? Have you been exposed to that? Okay, that's how it's handled in the laboratory. BSL-3 is when you have to put the space suit on in order to handle the organisms. You know, you've seen it on TV where they have the space suit and they're hooked up to oxygen and they're walking around like this and everything's in a hood. And that's the kind of precautions that you have to take with tularemia and brucella. That's how contagious it is. So when you're dealing with situations where you have to wear spacesuits in order to work with it, you know that they expect you to be extremely careful with this organism. BSL-2 means you have to work in a laminar flow hood, and you have to wear a mask and gloves and lab coats. Well, you should always wear a lab coat anyway, but you have to be extremely careful, but you don't have to wear a space suit. So basically, if you're working with these bottom two, with Francisella and Brucella, you know, if you're working with a space suit, you pretty much, the precautions speak for themselves. with anthrax and Yersinia, you just have to be extremely careful. You have to take droplet precautions. With the patients, you really don't have to take that many precautions because there's no person-to-person spread. Of course, if you're going to be dealing with the fluids and materials, you want to be cautious, because if you have any cuts or abrasions on your hands, you don't want to come in contact with the organism. Again, here, you don't want to come in contact with the organism, so you want to make sure that you protect yourself. This is the key. Fear, in most of these cases, is more of an enemy than the organism itself. Know which of the biological warfare agents occurs naturally in your area. If you live in the desert southwest, Yersinia pestis is there. If there is a biological attack, you need to stay calm. Even if your insides are jumping around like Mexican jumping beans, you have to stay calm on the outside. You need to remind people that they don't need to rush to the hospital or to the doctor's office, because you're going to be overwhelmed with people. The hospitals are going to be overwhelmed with people. The more people that remain calm, the better. Help your family members to understand the facts and your friends to understand the facts. Don't let the news media and sensational reporting distract you from accurate information. We've seen it. We've seen the craziness that the news media, CNN, Fox, they all go nuts. They all, you know, the big headlines and the next day just disappears because it was wrong or it was sensationalized and the information that they gave you was just not correct. Since 9/11, the government has spent $50 billion $50 billion to improve the way we detect and respond to biological threats. The progress has been limited, and some security experts say the threat is greater than it ever was. They put these sensors in subways to detect particles. Well, you know, every time the subway train goes by, there's a huge number of particles that are generated. A lot of dirt gets kicked up. And they go off. Does that mean there's been a biological attack? No, that means there's been a whole lot of dirt kicked up. There's been a lot of money wasted because people are afraid. Fear is the enemy. Okay, I have another scenario for you. On April 1st, 2009, a 20-year-old male student from the University of North Carolina comes home to visit his family in Casey. While he's at home, he develops a fever. Rapidly progresses to shortness of breath, chest pains, dry cough, headache, chills, rigors, generalized body aches, coryza, and a sore throat. On April the 5th, his mother takes him to the ER with severe shortness of breath, chest pain, and a dry cough. His clinical exam shows an undifferentiated febrile illness with incipient pneumonia, pleuritis, and Hiller lymphadenopathy. Let's stop right here. Okay. What could it be? Could be anything, couldn't it? I mean, it could be anything. He has pneumonia. He could have the flu with a secondary pneumonia. He has lymphadenopathy. Okay, if it's bad enough, it could be what? Could be Francisella. Could be pestis. Could be a lot of things. Whatever. Let's move on. Okay, he came home 3 days after the NCAA basketball tournament. The Sweet 16 was in Charlotte. He went to it. There were a lot of people there. What kind of things are you going to look for? Well, one of the things that you can look for is, are there any other cases? Has anybody else reported an illness in people that went to that? I'm sure here in Columbia, there are a lot of people that would have gone to that tournament because it's close. And there are a lot of basketball fans. Contact the CDC, or not the CDC, but contact DHEC. See if there's anybody else who's reported any of these situations. You could start doing some tests. You know, okay, it's pneumonia. You're gonna test for pneumonia. You're gonna do some blood cultures, do some sputum cultures. Check to see what organism it could be. It's an unusual respiratory disease in its early stages. It could be difficult to distinguish it from a natural outbreak of community acquired infection, especially influenza or various atypical pneumonias. Again, you know, it could be anything.
Did you contact the CDC?
Not the CDC early.
DHEC with just one case?
Probably not. But if you were really suspicious, you could. You're not, it never hurts to just say, you know, I just got this strange pneumonia, and I was just wondering if there have been any other strange pneumonias. But you might want to wait till you have the blood cultures or the sputum cultures. But again, a lot of times if you wait, and I'm sure that there are protocols that DHEC has come up with for clinicians, and again, you'll get those with your practice. Okay, what would you expect? Well, with tularemia, you would expect a slower progression of illness. You wouldn't expect it to go from just flu-like symptoms to full-out pneumonia, miserable, in a couple of days. You'd expect it to take a bit longer. So, and you would expect a lower case fatality rate than you would with inhalational plague or with anthrax. So, since it's very, very quick, you would lean more towards the plague or anthrax. With plague, you would expect it to progress very rapidly into severe pneumonia with copious, watery, purulent sputum, hemoptysis, respiratory insufficiency, sepsis, and shock. You could differentiate the anthrax. Now, and this goes beyond what I know, because the radiological findings are different with anthrax. And the anthrax, when you start giving them antibiotics, it doesn't help them any. So this is how you would differentiate the three different types of the biological agents or bioterrorist agents. And if it was like the Q fevers and all, you couldn't really do that without the reference labs because of the diagnostics. And you'll get that in the next few sets of lectures. And here, lab diagnosis of plague and anthrax you could make very quickly. So again, if you thought it could be plague or anthrax, you could get those results within 24 hours. So you could start them on, you could get your samples, start them on antibiotics, and it wouldn't hurt to wait before you contacted anybody. If you thought it could be tularensis, you might want to go ahead and contact someone because it's going to take a while to get results. So, and that's the end. Any questions?